In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
Some weeks ago, I studied with you about the church and the New Testament church, and we looked at many scriptures, and we're not going to look at all those scriptures again, but I need to review just a few things that we studied then before I studied with you what I want to study with you today, which is also what the Bible, and especially the New Testament, says about the church. And as Seventh-day Adventists, we are wonderfully privileged to have the testimonies of the Holy Spirit to help us understand exactly what these Bible writers were talking about. It's not adding new light, it's finding the old light that we've had all along but has been lost. And so we're going to look at it again today, but first let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to study. Father in heaven, we thank you for the light of truth that you have given to us in your word. And we thank you for the spirit of prophecy that guides us back to what the Bible writers wrote and what they said. And we pray that you will help us to be part of that group of people who live by every word that proceeds out of your mouth. Help us now to understand what we study and to put it into practice in our life. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. When we spoke about this before, we gave many texts to substantiate, we gave texts of Scripture to substantiate each point, but we're going to just rapidly review, and I'm not going to give you all the texts of Scripture to substantiate the points that we covered then. We showed then that the church is old. It goes back thousands of years because Stephen, the day that he was martyred, that very day he preached a sermon and talked about the church that was in the wilderness, clear back at the time of Moses. So the church is very old. It goes back thousands of years. And in the time of Moses, the church was highly organized. We showed scriptures for that. They were so highly organized that there actually was death penalties if you violated certain ordinances of the church in those days. And we saw that Jesus had a special regard for the church. The church had a location, they had a headquarters. It was located first at Shiloh, and later the headquarters was at Jerusalem, but they had synagogues throughout the land. But Jesus had a special regard for the church of God. He attended it every Sabbath. And he was an active participant in the worship services. We saw in John, the second chapter, that Jesus had an intense interest in the church and that he respected the offices of the priests and told the people after they were healed that they were to go and to show themselves to the priest as Moses had commanded. We also saw that in the Bible the church is spoken of in symbolic language, symbolized by a vineyard. And Jesus talked about this prophetic symbolism in Matthew 21. He gave the parable of the husbandmen or the vine dressers, and they killed the servants of the Lord that were sent to them, and when the Son was sent to them, they decided to murder him. And if you look in your Bible, in Matthew 21, this is what Jesus said was going to happen to the Jewish people because they decided to murder the Messiah. Matthew 21:43. Jesus said, "Therefore I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken from you and given to a nation bearing the fruits of it." So Jesus said that The kingdom of God would be taken away from them. They were not going to be God's special chosen people anymore. He said to them in Matthew 23:38, "See, your house is left to you desolate." Of course, any house becomes desolate when God leaves it. But before their final rejection of the Jewish people, Jesus provided a dwelling place for himself, a church that would be the depository of God's truth on earth. A considerable time before the final rejection of the Jews as a nation, Jesus laid the foundation of the Christian church, which was to take over the vineyard and become God's custodian of truth for the world. And since Jesus has gone back to heaven, his chief work has been on behalf of his church in this world. You want to read that in the Bible? We read it that day. We can read that text again. Turn in your Bible to the book of Revelation, the first chapter. Revelation, the first chapter. This is John having a vision on the Isle of Patmos where he was banished. And he says in verse 12, he says, "I turned to see the voice that spoke with me, and having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands." Those are the seven golden lampstands in the heavenly sanctuary, in the first apartment of the heavenly sanctuary, and Christ is standing and walking amidst those seven golden lampstands. You can see that in verse 13. And then notice what he said, he writes, or Jesus, he writes the words of Jesus in verse 20. He says, "The mystery of the seven stars which you saw in my right hand and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands which you saw are the seven churches." And then you have immediately the letter to the seven churches. And of course, seven is a number that represents perfection. This is a number that indicates that Jesus is giving a message to all of the Christian churches from then until the end of time. And so the book of Revelation is not like the book of Daniel. The book of Daniel was written actually to help people that are atheists and infidels to be convinced of the deity and authority of the God of heaven. You can see that easily if you start reading the book of Daniel. But the book of Revelation is not written like that. It is written especially to God's servants. That's what it says right in the first few verses of the book. It is written to the church. And what is God's design for his church? I want to read to you a sentence from the book Desire of Ages, page 680. And then I want to study, what does that sentence mean? It says, this is Desire of Ages, page 680. "Christ designs that heaven's order, heaven's plan of government, heaven's divine harmony shall be represented in his church on earth." Notice three things. Christ designs that heaven's order, heaven's plan of government, and heaven's divine harmony shall be represented in his church on earth. Do you understand what heaven's order involves? Now, heaven, of course, is the home at the present time of the angels. And if you're a Christian, you're hoping that in the future that it's going to become your home too, and that you will be able to live and associate with the angels. Are you ready to go live with angels? You have to be ready to go live with angels if you're going to go to heaven. And of course, the church on earth and the church in heaven is just one church. And when Jesus comes, he's going to take his church on earth, and he's going to take it to the church to heaven where the angels live, where they are. And if you're going to go, you have to be prepared to live with angels. Have you studied about the angels, how they live, how they work, what they do? I want to read to you from volume 1, page 64950, about the angels and about how they work, how they operate. The first sentence here, it says, angels work harmoniously. Perfect order characterizes all their movements. They work harmoniously, and perfect order characterizes all their movements. And then, Ellen White writes, the more closely we imitate the harmony and order of the angelic host, the more successful will be the efforts of these heavenly agents in our behalf. If we see no necessity for harmonious action and are disorderly, undisciplined, and disorganized in our course of action, angels who are thoroughly organized and move in perfect order cannot work for us successfully. And so, she says, they turn away in grief. Why? Because they are not authorized to bless confusion, distraction, and disorganization. Angels are authorized to bless that. All who desire the cooperation of the heavenly messengers must work in unison with them. Those who have the unction from on high will in all their efforts encourage order, discipline, and union of action. Because if we do that, then the angels can cooperate with us. She goes on to say, but never, never will these heavenly messengers place their endorsement upon irregularity, disorganization, and disorder. Would you like to see our church come into a condition where the angels of God could do much more for us than they're doing now? Would you like to see that happen? Well, if you would like to see that happen, if you would like to see the power of God revealed, we must listen to this divine counsel. We must come into order. We must not be irregular or disorganized or disorderly. Then she goes on to say, all these evils, that's irregularity, disorganization, and disorder, are the result of Satan's efforts to weaken our forces, to destroy courage, and prevent successful action. Satan well knows what success can only attend order and harmonious action. He well knows that everything connected with heaven is in perfect order, that subjection and thorough discipline mark the movements of the angelic host. Say, did you get that word subjection? Do you know what that means? We're going to take a look at that. That's a word that keeps coming up when you start studying about the angels. It is his studied efforts, that's Satan's studied effort, to lead professed Christians just as far from heaven's arrangement as he can. Therefore, he deceives even the professed people of God and makes them believe that order and discipline are enemies to spirituality, that the only safety for them is to let each pursue his own course and to remain especially distinct from bodies of Christians who are united and are laboring to establish discipline and harmony of action. All the efforts made to establish order are considered dangerous, a restriction of rightful liberty, and hence are feared as popery. These deceived souls consider it a virtue to boast of their freedom, to think and act independently. They will not take any man's say-so. They are amenable to no man. I was shown that it is Satan's special work to lead men to feel that it is in God's order for them to strike out for themselves and choose their own course independent of their brethren. Now, You don't have to remind me. I am very well aware that what I'm talking about is an extremely unpopular subject. It is a lesson that is very difficult for us stubborn human beings to learn. I am still working at it. When I was a young minister, the first district that my wife and I were assigned to pastor was in Fargo, North Dakota. Now, I had never lived in North Dakota before. In fact, I'm not even sure that I'd ever been in the state of North Dakota before that time. So we drove up there in our car, and it was around the 1st of September. It was nice up there. And I got up there, and we had a little church. It was the biggest city in the state, but a very small church. And pretty soon we found that we had to raise an in-gathering goal of about almost $3,000. We only had a handful of people to do it. We didn't have very many contacts. And it must have taken us 6 weeks or more to get that in-gathering goal. And I can remember, we used to have a loudspeaker. We didn't have, this was long before CDs, but we did have cassette tape recorders. And we had a cassette tape recorder, and we hooked it up to a loudspeaker on the top of a car, and we would play Christmas carols. I had to go down. I wasn't used to making all kind of arrangements like this. You couldn't do this in Fargo, North Dakota without permission from the city. So I had to go down and talk to the mayor. And the way had been paved before me. It just so happened that this mayor, some years before, he had an Adventist minister had been a good friend of his. So he had a soft spot in his heart toward us, and he gave me permission. He gave me permission to do this, and we had this tape recorder in the car, and then we had the loudspeaker on top, and we would play Christmas carols going down the street. We'd have people on either side knocking on doors soliciting for money, and it was cold. We were doing this in November and December. And by the way, if you haven't been up north, it's quite a bit colder in North Dakota than Kansas. It's even colder than Nebraska. It's even colder than South Dakota. Just watch this winter. Just when you see a map of the United States, just look what the temperatures are. Every state you go north, it's a few degrees colder than the one before. And I would be out there all dressed up in warm clothes, knocking on doors, and sometimes I'd be walking down the street and knocking on doors, and I would think, what in the world am I here for? What am I here for? Am I this untalented that I've got to do this? If what the cause of Christ really needs is money, I should have. If that's what it needs, I should have just gone into business. I could make way more money and give to the church than I'm ever going to raise doing this. So what in the world am I doing this for? You know why I was doing it? Because that was the place that I was assigned to work for God at that time. And I had to get to the place where I said, all right, Lord, if this is the place where you want me to work, then as long as you want me to work here, I'll work here. You see, the angels work in perfect harmony and perfect order. And I'd like you to see some things about heaven's order. Remember, Jesus designs that heaven's order is going to be seen and represented in his church on earth. I want to look at just a few things quickly about heaven's order. First of all, there are no politics in heaven. They do not have any political campaigns. They did have a political campaign a few years ago. It was conducted by a leading angel by the name of Lucifer, but that political campaign ended as so many campaigns have ended. You know, they had a political campaign in 1860 in the United States, and And the result of that was the Civil War. And the political campaign that Lucifer started has resulted in a civil war, and Lucifer was cast out of heaven. But since that time, they don't have any political campaigns. There's no politics in heaven. Second thing that we just read about is that there is perfect order in heaven. And this is actually very scary to me. I study about this. In fact, I pray about this. When I was a small child, I was so disorderly that, first of all, I never wanted to go to sleep. I don't know if any of you ever had that problem. When I was a small child, I never wanted to take a nap, and I never wanted to go to bed on time. I wanted to stay up and do something. I never wanted to do that. But that was just the beginning. When it came time in the morning, I couldn't find my clothes because I just threw them off when I got off and went to bed, and I was looking all over the place trying to find my shoes. See, I wasn't very orderly. Order does not just have to do with our possessions, however. Order has to do with time. Order has to do with time. If I understand order, then I have a place for things, and things are in their place. And I have a time, there's a time for things, and things are on time. God is so orderly that you can set your clock by the revolutions of the bodies in the heavens that He has for us to look at. And we have done that. We've kept time by means of the heavenly bodies since ancient times. And when I used to pilot airplanes, pilots get charts. I don't know, with all the electronics we have now, I don't know if they do that anymore, but used to print charts, and you could get a chart and it would show you the exact minute for sundown and sunrise, because if you're piloting a plane, it's very important to know when you're going to be at some place, is it going to be light or is it going to be dark? In fact, you have to be current in flying at night, otherwise it's unlawful for you to fly and land a plane at nighttime, because it's a different landing the plane at nighttime than in the daytime. It's a completely different experience. Visually, it just, everything looks different. And so all pilots have these charts where it tells you the exact minute. You know, and they can tell you the exact minute anywhere in the United States, the exact minute for Wichita or Kansas City or Denver or Los Angeles or New York City, they can tell you the exact minute when the sun is going to go down and the sun is going to come up for the whole next year. You get a chart for a whole year, it'll tell you the exact minute. Because God is orderly. Everything in heaven is orderly. I've told you before that one of the lessons that God has given us in the Ten Commandments, it's right in the heart of the Ten Commandments, has to do with time management. And because I was a disorderly person growing up, and it's something that I have had to work on, even when I was a young minister, I had trouble being on time. Right on time for the beginning of the Sabbath. And I finally figured out, I'm never going to be on time. I'm either going to be early or late. So I decided I want to be early, so I won't be late. So I had to start developing techniques. I know what minute the sun's going to go down. I need to start thinking this through, planning my day, figuring it out so that I'm going to be early and not late. So there is perfect order in heaven. Now, I'm not saying this to threaten anybody, but I do want you to think. If I am going to go to a place where there is perfect order, do you think that it's going to be necessary for me to learn how to be a perfectly orderly person? It's scary for most of us to think about, isn't it? Here's another thing I've learned as I've studied about heaven's order. Among the angels, there are no star players. They are all team players. In other words, the angels work together for common goals. They're not competing with one another. They don't have a star player, somebody that, well, he's the champion. No, they work together as team players for a common goal. Let me read you something like that. This is from the book Desire of Ages, page 789. This incident will show very clearly that the angels work together as a team. It says, when the mighty angel came down to the tomb, that's Christ's tomb, he was joined by another. So an angel came down from heaven to the tomb of Christ, and when he got there, he was joined by another angel. So now there's two standing by the tomb. He was joined by another who with his company, that's his company of angels, had been keeping guard over the Lord's body. As the angel from heaven rolled away the stone. So the angel that came from down from heaven, he rolled away the stone from the tomb. And as he did that, notice what happens. As the angel from heaven rolled away the stone, the other entered the tomb. So one angel rolls away the stone, the other walks into the tomb. You see, they're working together. And unbound the wrappings from the body of Jesus. If you start looking for it, you will find many places in inspired writings that show us that the angels work together as a team. Now, that type of order is to be represented and revealed in God's church on earth. Now, when we say that the angels work together as a team, that does not mean that they do not have supervisors. The angels have, there are supervising angels, and the angels obey orders. I want to read you several quick statements that you'll see that right away. Now, this is also from the book Desire of Ages. It's written in Desire of Ages, written also in early writings, actually. The angels are watching at the trial of Christ, at his trial, and they are not happy with what they're seeing. And notice what Ellen White writes about this. She says, under God, the angels are all powerful. How easily could the angels beholding the shameful scene of the trial of Christ have testified their indignation by consuming the adversaries of God, but they were not commanded to do this? Let me tell you, they wanted to do it. They were angry at what the people were doing to Jesus. And they had the least powerful angel, the weakest angel, could have instantly destroyed them all. But why didn't they? They wanted to, because they were not commanded to do this. They follow orders. Notice what she says about it in the book Early Writings. It was difficult for the angels to endure the sight. They would have delivered Jesus, but the commanding angels forbade them, saying that it was a great ransom which was to be paid for man, but it would be complete and would cause the death of him who had the power of death. The weakest angel could have caused that mocking throng to fall powerless and could have delivered Jesus. Just one angel. Boom. There would have been instant deliverance. But there was no. There was a commanding angel. What did he say? No, you can't do that. Because if they had delivered Jesus so that he had not been crucified, then there would be no salvation for a lost world. The angels obey orders. This is another description of what happened during the trial of Jesus. They covered his head, that's his tormentors, Jesus' tormentors. They covered his head with an old garment, blindfolding him, and then struck him in the face and cried out, "Prophesy, who is it that smote thee?" Now notice what happened when this happened. Ellen White says, "There was commotion among the angels. They would have rescued him instantly." But their commanding angels restrained them. They said, "No, you can't do it." They obey orders. Are you ready to go into a society like that? There is perfect order, and they obey orders. One other thing that we're not going to study this morning, if the Lord wills, I might study with you sometime. But in my research on this subject, I have found that in this world of sin and the great controversy that's going on, that although there are commanding angels, there is a chief general who gives orders, to all the angels. That chief general who gives orders to all the angels is the Holy Spirit. That's another subject that we're not going to study right now. But let me ask you this question. Should the church be governed and directed by the Holy Spirit, or should the church be governed and directed by human councils and theologians and all that sort of thing? I want to read to you a statement that shows, in fact, this statement to my mind shows us more why we're in trouble in the church on earth than any other statement. You're going to see when I read this statement that unless the church is directed, guided, controlled by the Holy Spirit, we can't do our work. We'll never get the gospel to the world. We'll never get the three angels' message to all the world. It'll never happen. Here's the statement. This is Desire of Ages, page 805. She quotes from John 20. You remember when Jesus met them? He said, "Peace to you." And then he said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Here's what Ellen White comments about that. "The Holy Spirit was not yet fully manifested, for Christ had not yet been glorified." He was not glorified until after his ascension to heaven. "The more abundant impartation of the Spirit did not take place till after Christ's ascension. Not until this was received could the disciples fulfill the commission to preach the gospel to the world. But the Spirit was now given for a special purpose. Before the disciples could fulfill their official duties in connection with the church, Christ breathed his Spirit upon them." Now that's a very interesting statement. She says before the apostles could fulfill their official duties in the church, in a few weeks we'll have 2017 officers in this church. Different people have different official duties. But she said here that before they could fulfill their official duties, what had to happen first? They had to receive the Holy Spirit. That's why Christ breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." The fullness of the Holy Spirit had not been given yet. That wouldn't be until the day of Pentecost. But Christ breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit," because she says until they received the Holy Spirit, they could not fulfill their official duties in the church, let alone give the gospel to all the world. They couldn't even fulfill their duties in the church. He, that is Christ, was committing to them a most sacred trust, and he desired to impress them with the fact. What was the fact that Jesus wanted to impress them with? Here it is. He desired to impress them with the fact that without the Holy Spirit, this work could not be accomplished. So, have we received the Holy Spirit? You know, friends, that was a question that the Apostle Paul used to use when he met believers with which he was not acquainted.
he would say, "Have you received the Holy Spirit?"
And one time, when he met, in Acts 19, when he met some people and asked them if they had received the Holy Spirit, they didn't know. He said, "Well, what were you baptized for?" You remember on the day of Pentecost, Peter said to the people, when they, these are the people that were responsible for crucifying Jesus, and when Peter preached to them and they realized how terrible they were and how guilty they were, they said, "Well, what are we going to do?" And Peter said, "Repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." So the promise on the day of Pentecost was that everyone, when they were baptized, would receive the Holy Spirit. And that was God's intention for anyone that was baptized. A person is not to be baptized until they're prepared to receive the Holy Spirit. By the way, that's why we do not baptize infants. Because you cannot receive the Holy Spirit without faith, and an infant cannot exercise faith yet. That does not mean that they cannot be saved. There will be a multitude of people in the kingdom of heaven who died in infancy, many of them as martyrs, by the way. But to be a member of the church, to conduct the business of the church, to do the mission of the church, requires the Holy Spirit, otherwise it cannot be done. And so, after the ascension of Christ, it was God's will that everyone, on walking into the door, on becoming a member of the church, would receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The statement that we read in Desire of Ages, page 680, indicated that not only was heaven's order to be manifested in Christ's church, but also heaven's plan of government. Let's look real quickly at three things that they don't have in heaven's plan of government. Number one, they do not have hierarchies. Now, I don't know if you understand how significant that statement is. The Jewish church was hierarchically organized. If you are a student of prophecy, and if you have studied prophetic parallels between the first advent and the second advent, that statement, that fact should give you pause. The Jewish church at the time of the first advent was organized as a hierarchy. That's very clear in the spirit of prophecy, and the work of Christ tended to break down that hierarchy. But the church in heaven does not have hierarchies. Why? Because Jesus explained it very clearly. Look in your Bible in Matthew 23. Matthew 23. Start reading in verse 6. Jesus here is rebuking the scribes and Pharisees. And he says, "They love the best places at the feasts, the best seats in the synagogues, greetings in the markets, and to be called by men Rabbi, Rabbi." That's equivalent, by the way. Rabbi is equivalent, if you look in a dictionary, is equivalent to the word Monsignor. "But you do not be called Rabbi, for one is your teacher, the Christ, and you are all brethren. Do not call anyone on earth your father, for one is your father, he who is in heaven. Do not be called teachers or commanders, for one is your teacher, the Christ. But he who is greatest among you shall be your servant, and whoever exalts himself will be abased, and he who humbles himself will be exalted." Notice, in heaven they don't have hierarchy. In the church in heaven they do not have hierarchy. Let's read it from the words, the way the Apostle Paul explains it in 1 Corinthians 8. 1 Corinthians 8, Paul says in verses 5 and 6, "Even if there are so-called gods, whether in heaven or on earth, as there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is only one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we for him, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we live." So, If heaven's plan of government is to be represented in God's church on earth, that church cannot be organized as a hierarchy. Drop that. You can study that more out on your own. In the church in heaven, they do not have competition or rivalry or contention or fighting. But what is it like? Here's a few points on what it's like. Number one, it is a kingdom. It is a kingdom. That's a major subject of the Gospel of Matthew. Christ's church is a spiritual kingdom. He is the Lord of that kingdom. Number two, all the people are subject to the king and the law of the king, including the angels. That was a point of contention at the beginning of the great controversy. Lucifer said that angels should not be subject or not be under law. But the angels in heaven are all under law. The redeemed will all be under law. A third point is Revelation 12:17 makes it very clear that God's last church on earth will have the spirit of prophecy. Now, let me ask you a quick question before we go on to another point. When Revelation 12:17, you can compare it with Revelation 19:10, which says the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. When it says that God's last people on earth will have the spirit of prophecy, what do you think that that means? Does that mean that you will have a series of black books or red books or some other kind of books on your bookshelf? Is that what it means? What does it mean to have the testimony of Jesus? Let's read it in the Bible. So it's nobody will say that I said it. I'll just read you what the Bible says. Look in 1 Corinthians, the first chapter. 1 Corinthians, the first chapter. Verses 5 and 6. You were enriched in everything by him in all utterance and all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you. What does it mean to have the testimony of Christ confirmed in you? That means it's in your mind, in your life, or you're living in harmony with it. In order for heaven's plan of government to be manifested in God's church on earth, that church has to be living in harmony with inspired writings. Does that make sense? The angels, as we have already studied, they obey orders. And the angels are organized like an army. Let me read you just a statement or two about that. This is what happened when the devil rebelled in heaven. It says, the angels were marshaled in companies, each division with a higher commanding angel. They were marshaled together in companies. And ever since that time, the angels observe strict order, even when they go out from heaven and come back. Ellen White had a vision about that. Did you know that in heaven, right today, you cannot just go in or come out? You cannot go in or come out without showing ID. See, the devil and his angels, they can't go in because they don't have the proper ID. Let me read that to you. This is early writings, page 39. There is perfect order and harmony in the holy city. All the angels that are commissioned to visit the earth hold a golden card, which they present to the angels at the gates of the city as they pass in and out. When they come in, they present the card. They can go in. When they come out, they present the card. They can go out. They have order. And each angel has a special work to do. Angels don't just come down here and look over, let's see what I can do for the Lord today. They don't do that. That is disorganized. I'll just go out here, I'll just get some literature out here or there, I'll visit somebody here or there, I'll go and see what I can. That's not how the angels work. They are organized in their work. Let me read that to you. It says, this is about the angels in heaven. This is clear back at the beginning. The happiness of the angelic host consisted in their perfect obedience to law. Each had his special work assigned him. And until Satan rebelled, there had been perfect order and harmonious action in heaven. So each angel had his particular work assigned to him. And they accept the assignment that they're given. Ellen White wrote once to a young minister and his wife, and they hadn't learned about this yet. And this is what she wrote to them. With the spirit of self-confidence that you now possess, neither of you could be happy in heaven. For there all, even the exalted angels, are subordinate. You have yet to learn subordination and submission. You see, if I don't learn that, then I won't be able to go. That is scary too, when you see what happens among God's professed people today. If we do not learn that lesson, we won't be able to go. Let me read you a couple more statements about that quickly. This is not about at the beginning. This is about right now today. Each angel has his particular post of duty, which he is not permitted to leave for any other place. Now that's interesting. Each angel that comes down to this world has an assigned place and an assigned job and an assigned duty, and the angel is not allowed to just go anywhere else. He goes to where his assignment is. Well, as I was studying about this, I found out Ellen White illustrates the order that the angels have in heaven by telling us about the order that the children of Israel had in the wilderness. And that is very interesting to study, but we do not have time to study that now. The children of Israel in the wilderness, by the way, before Moses became their leader in Egypt, I was reading about Moses last night. In Egypt, he had been a general, and she said, his ability as a general could not be surpassed by any man, by any human being. Moses knew how to organize people, and the children of Israel were highly organized. They all started at the same time. They all stopped at the same time. They all pitched their tent in an assigned place. They all marched in order, and they received orders from the front. Those assisting Moses had trumpets, and they gave signals by the trumpets, and then they had leaders over each section that told them exactly what they were required to do. They had perfect order. That was a sample of what God wants to happen among his people throughout all time. Here's another statement about it. The Lord gives to every angel his work for this fallen world. And what are these angels trying to do? The angels are trying to help us come into the same kind of order and harmony that they already have. We don't have it yet. Here's what they're trying to do. I'll read it. Heavenly angels are working to bring the human family into a close brotherhood, a oneness described by Christ as like that existing between the Father and the Son. They're working to help us to come into line, to come into order, perfect order, the way they already are. Now, as I was thinking about this, I ran onto something interesting that I thought would be interesting to the people of our church at this time of year, since we just had the first reading for our officers for 2017. Now, this is something we have tried to do this before, but we have never totally succeeded. But maybe we could succeed in doing this next year if we all started praying about it. What would the Lord like to see happen in our churches so that we could become more organized, more orderly, more effective in our work? This was written in the Australian Union Conference record. Part of these statements were recorded in the Book of Evangelism. It says, in our churches, let companies be formed for service. In the Lord's work, there are to be no idlers. Let different ones unite in labor as fishers of men. Let them seek to gather souls from the corruption of the world into the saving purity of Christ's love. The formation of small companies as a basis of Christian effort is a plan that has been presented before me by one who cannot err. If there is a large number in the church, let the members be formed into small companies to work not only for the church members, but for unbelievers. Let me ask you something. It's not a hard question. It's an easy question. Do you think God has changed since the time of Moses and the children of Israel, or do you think that God is still the same? What does your Bible tell you? The Bible tells you that God does not change. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever, the Bible says. Second statement I quoted is from the book of Hebrews. The first one is from the book of Malachi. So if God was a God of order then, God is still a God of order now. Now, my dear friends, I'm not presenting this subject to you because I've arrived, because you need to pray for me. I'm praying that I can arrive, but I haven't arrived yet. But what could happen? What could happen if there was a church, a local church anywhere in the world? If there was a local church anywhere in the world where heaven's order, heaven's plan of government, and heaven's harmony was developed in a local church, if that happened anywhere in the world, do you know what would happen? Well, our time is up. But I have done a little study on this. And if the Lord wills, at a preaching revival service, I'm going to show you what would happen. And it's something that has never happened since Pentecost, but it's going to happen again. And I would like to be part of it. Would you like to be part of it? If we're going to be part of it, what has to happen in us? Well, heaven's order, heaven's plan of government, and heaven's harmony has to be developed among us. Are you willing to pray that the Lord will bring us into that kind of a condition? Before we sing our closing song, let's pray about this. Our Father in heaven, we give you thanks that you have assigned angels to each one of us, and that we have an angel guardian that is with us all the days of our life, as long as we do not commit the unpardonable sin. And we earnestly pray, as we think about their order, their government, their perfection, we pray that you will bring us to that condition, that the order that there is in heaven, that their type of government and that their harmony might develop among us, that we might have that harmony and unity that Christ prayed for that we were to have, so that your work can be finished in the world quickly. We pray this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.